this day. Come on, give the Lord a praise on this day. And the Bible says that this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. But there is no one thing that you need to stand on your feet. You need to stand on your feet with a revelation of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Giving thanks unto the Lord, for he is good.
Oh, we thank God for Ministry Grady. I didn't know he was there, my son.
Such as should be saved. Pastor Doug?
I decided to pray for me. I took that second flu shot last Thursday. Mm-hmm. And it just, Friday, I felt like I had been hit by a mad truck.
Yes.
And today I can't even turn my neck. Mm-hmm. So pray for me that the Lord will deliver my body.
Yes. 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 And I was looking for my old family in the child.
Yes. Your mom's five.
Yes.
Pastor.
Yes.
My cousin, Tracy.
Amen.
I thank God for being here today. I thank God for bringing me over the highway. I came from Virginia.
Amen.
And I truly thank the Lord for it. My cousin's not here today at work.
Mm-hmm.
God is faithful to you. God is faithful to you. Hallelujah. God is faithful.
Sylvester Quinn, if you would come lead us in prayer. And after that, we're going to turn it over to Deacon Fields to come read us a resurrection scripture. Amen. And then we'll turn it back over to our praise team.
Yeah.
Amen. Before he starts praying, I'm going to anoint Pastor Duck.
Yeah.
We need Pastor Duck.
Myself, that where I am, there ye may be also.
And when I go, ye know, and the way ye know. Thomas says to him, Lord, we know not whither thou goest, and how can we know the way? Jesus says unto him, let's read it all together. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. May the Lord have a blessing to the reading of his word.
Lord, I love. because you're the only one that's deserving. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Let's worship in spirit and in truth, amen. That's what the Lord desires. That's what he requires from us, amen. Hallelujah. We bless your name today, Father. We don't take it for granted. We don't take it lightly. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. We bless you. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. There's been so many obstacles trying to stop us, Father, but you made a way. Hallelujah. You alone, you made the way. Hallelujah. And we bless you today. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
He's wonderful. He's magnificent. He's worthy to be praised from the rising of the sun until the going down of the same. We thank and praise God for our praise and worship team. Come on, give God a praise for them. Thank God for the man. Amen. Thank God for all of you that have come to be here in the household of faith in this resurrection morning. It's time to celebrate. It's time to give thanks unto the Lord. It's time to magnify the name of the Lord, for he is good and his mercy endureth forever. And this tradition that we have our children come at this time. Thank you, Lord. And I believe that they're going to render some scriptures. They may have a poem. They may do a dance. They may sing a song. They may make the altar call. Hallelujah. So they may do it all. Hallelujah. So we want them to come at this time, led by none other than our honorable sister, amen, Yolanda Hall. Amen. I just thank God for our children. Y'all step up a little bit. Y'all move up off y'all. Just move up off y'all a little bit. Just a little bit. Y'all move up. Step up. Take one step up. There you go. Amen. I believe somebody called them little friends of Jesus. Amen. Little friends of Jesus. Yes.
Amen. Praise the Lord. They have Bible verses this Resurrection Sunday. So we're going to start by Sister Dynasty. Can you please use your outside voices with your Bible verse? Take your mask off for a moment. Up under your tent.
Pastor, when you learn that song from? Amen. I didn't know she was going to be singing it today. Come on, give God a praise. What a happy day. Wasn't it a happy day? Thank you, Lord. I was adding out my preachers and evangelists while they were standing up quoting them scriptures. We certainly do thank God for each and every one of you. We thank God for the service thus far. We thank God for Sister Yohana putting that together, working with the children. Thank God for the parents helping them to learn those scriptures. Amen. It's quoting, reading and learning the scriptures is one thing, but saying them in public is a whole different thing. Amen. So for them to stand up here to do a form of public speaking, come on and give God a praise for that. Have my children do some book reports and then give us a synopsis on what they learned to help them with public speaking. So we thank God that's an idea for your parents to help your children. They can learn something and then they also can present it. So we praise God for it. All right. It's offering time in the sanctuary. Offering time in the sanctuary. This is a time that we can give unto the Lord so that we all can be blessed. Amen? The Bible says it's more blessed to give than to receive. And we certainly do thank God for this portion of the service that we may give of our tithes and our offering. Amen. God has required of us tithes and offering. Tithes represent 10% of all your increase. And then the offering is a free will offering unto the Lord. And I learned through study is that when you change the form of your tithes and offerings, and you give your tithes as offerings, you change the blessing that's attached to it. There's a blessing that's attached to your tithes. God said that he would rebuke the devourer, pour you out a blessing, that you don't have room enough to receive. Amen? And with your offering, there's another set of blessings connected with that. So we want to give you that opportunity to sow seed into the kingdom and bless the name of the Lord. And we have an usher that is standing in the middle. We want to ask you to stand as we get ready to pray. And then for people to move out row by row as she directs you into the middle to come up front. And as you walk up front, those that are going to ask you to move that chair over there. So those that are coming around this way may flow through that way. Those that are coming around through this way may come that way back to your respective seats. Amen. So as you raise your offering in your hand, thank you, Lord. We come before you, Lord, to give of our tithes and our offering and to command the blessings that you have attached to it in the name of Jesus. We pray, Lord, that you bless us 30, 60, and 100-fold. This we pray in Jesus' name, according to your will, according to your riches and glory, by Christ Jesus. Amen and amen. Amen. So we want you to come from the rear as you are led by our ushers. Amen. The Lord with me, come on and bless the Lord with me.
I'm gonna get you through Jesus.
Opening
soon. My goal is to open it in June, get that going by the end of June, and we're still working on employees and getting things together. So when it becomes open, we want you to help promote it and help invite people to it. Our serving age will be 2.5 years and up to age 12. 2.5 years old and up to age 12. So if you want to be a part of that and you have good clearances, you can see us and we'll get you an application. You can fill it out and it'll be a great wage. You'll work for a great boss. Amen. Amen. Oh, man. God, I get it. Thank you, Jesus. And you'll be able to influence and impact some great children. So that's the main thing. So we want you to prepare yourselves for that. And also, too, we want to prepare yourself for what's coming next is our mentorship program, our youth mentorship program, as we put that in place, called the Youth Development Academy. And then we're also going to put in place the renting of office space in our business section in the area upstairs. So we got a lot of things going on, a lot of irons in the fire. Amen, but it's all good. Tell somebody it's all good. Amen. Pastor Quinn, he helped on it. Amen. And we thank God that he has blessed us to be here on today. All right. I want you to turn with me to a verse of scripture out of the book of St. John. The book of St. John. I'll read before you long today. And we're going to ask the church to stand. And if you would stand with us, as is our custom, in the reading of the word. In the book of St. John, chapter number 20. The book of St. John, chapter number 20. If you haven't, say amen. Amen. And it reads as thus. St. John chapter number 20 and verse 24. It says, but Thomas, one of the 12 called Didymus, was not with them when Jesus came. The other disciples therefore said unto him, we have seen the Lord. But he said unto them, except I shall see in his hands the print of the nails, and put my fingers into the print of the nails, and thrust my hand into his side, I will not believe. And after 8 days, again his disciples were within, and Thomas with them. Then came Jesus, the door being shut, and stood in the midst and said, peace be unto you. Verse 27, then said he to Thomas, talking about Jesus, reach hither thy finger and behold my hands, and reach hither thy hand and thrust into my side. And he was, and be not faithless, but believe. Be not faithless, but believe. And Thomas answered and said unto him, my Lord and my God. And Jesus said unto him, Thomas, because thou hast seen me, thou hast believed. Blessed are they that have not seen and yet believe. Verse number 20. And many other signs truly did Jesus in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book, but these are written that ye might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing ye might have life through his name. Gracious Father, in the name of Jesus, we certainly do thank you, Lord, for this time that you have set aside for the preaching and the hearing of your word. We ask you, Lord, that you bless as we preach the gospel of Jesus Christ, which is the power of God unto salvation. Touch our hearts and our minds. Open up our understanding. Lord, grant clarity of thought and speech. Father, we give you glory and honor and praise. Heal the few sick among us. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. And I truly want to take a thought today from that 29th verse. And Jesus saith unto him, Thomas, because thou hast seen me, thou believest, thou believe. Blessed are they that have not seen and yet believe. And I want to just take a thought from that particular verse. Blessed are they that have not seen but yet believe. Blessed are they who have not seen but yet believe. When we look at this particular time, in this particular season, there's no doubt that we are gathered here together because of the resurrection, the death and burial of Jesus Christ, because it is Easter. And we celebrate our Lord and our Savior. We give him glory and honor and the praise. And we know that through the scriptures that Jesus Christ had already prophesied of his impending death. He told his disciples that he would die and that he would be raised again from the grave, and that repentance and remission of sins would be preached in his name, beginning in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and in the uttermost parts of the world. And the Bible says that when Jesus was taken by the Roman soldiers, he was first scourged, which means that he was beat. The Bible tells us that he was beat, and they beat him beyond recognition. And they smote him on the face, and they put a crown of thorns on his head. The Bible says that they parted his garments, his raiment, and the Bible is really being nice about it, but they really stripped him naked. And then they held him to a cross. They nailed him to a cross. They put nails in both his hands, and they put nails in his feet. And the Bible says that by the time that Jesus was expected to die, he gave up the ghost. But because they had put him on the cross along with those other thieves, they wanted to hurry the process along, and they wanted to break his legs so that he would literally suffocate on that cross. But by the time they came to Jesus, Jesus had already died. So they wanted to make sure that he was dead. So they took a sword and pierced him in the side. And when they pierced him in the side, the Bible says that out came blood and water. Out came blood and water. And the reason why it's giving you that details, I know we like to spiritualize a lot of things, and you can often say that blood and water was for your redemption, but literally they wanted to show you that he was suffocating on that cross, and he gave up the ghost, and he died for you and I. It wasn't the fact that they were crucified that killed Christ. It was the fact that he gave his life. He gave his life as a ransom for you and I. He died on that cross for you and I. It wasn't the nails that were holding him to the cross. It was his love for you and I that was holding him to the cross. It wasn't those Roman centurion soldiers that nailed him to the cross that kept him there. It was his commitment to you and I that kept him there. It was his commitment to you and I that allowed him to stay. And the Bible says that he was bruised for, he was wounded for our transgressions. And he was bruised for our iniquities. And the chastisement of our peace was laid upon him. And the scripture says, with his stripes, every time he took a beating, he took a licking for you. Every time he took a beating, he took a licking for me. He took a licking for you and I. And he gave up his life. And the scripture says that he died and he gave up the ghost. And after he gave up the ghost, he was on that cross, and the scripture says that two men that came, one was Ananias and the other was that soldier that came to Jesus by night, the Philippian that came to Jesus by night, Nicodemus, and asked for the body of Jesus, and they buried him in a borrowed tomb. And the Bible says that because of his death and because of what he went through, that he died a horrible death. He died a horrible death, and he was laid in that tomb dead. And the scripture says that after 3 days he rose again and got up out of the grave. So that brings us now to our scripture lesson that we're at here on today. And a lot of people have given Thomas or Didymus, Doubter, a hard time sometimes. But you know, he was there. He was there when the Lord got bruised. He was there when the Lord was crucified. He was there when the Lord was put to death. And you ever been in a car accident and saw the wreck and said, surely I don't know how anybody can survive after that. The wreck looked so bad, you say in your own mind, I don't know how anybody can endure that type of torture or be through that type of accident and survive after that. That's what Thomas went through. He, when his disciples told him that Jesus was alive, he said in his own mind, I won't believe it until I see it myself. I won't believe it because I saw the end of Jesus and it was pitiful. I saw him on that cross agonizing. I saw him on that cross thirsting. I saw him when he went through those Roman soldiers, how they beat him and crucified him and put him to death. And I just can't believe it. I just can't believe it. I won't believe it until I see it. Until I see it for myself. There's a lot of us that are like that. They come from Missouri. They come from the show me state. They said, unless I see it with my own eyes, I won't believe it. Unless I heard it with my own ears, I won't believe it. I won't believe it. I won't believe it. And when we come to our text on today, we see that it was necessary that Jesus appeared unto Thomas. And I like the fact that the Bible says that he waited 8 days until he came to talk to him. And that number 8 represents new beginnings. That represents new beginnings. You know, anytime that the Lord shows up in your life, it's an opportunity for a new beginning. Anytime that the Lord shows up, it's an opportunity for a new beginning. Today could be your new beginning. Today could be your new beginning. For the Bible says that if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. All things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. But in order for Thomas to have a new beginning, he has to believe. Anytime you're going to have a new beginning in your life, you've got to believe. You've got to believe on Jesus. As the scriptures have said, you've got to believe the report, because Jesus isn't a joke. Jesus is the one that's able to save your soul. He's able to turn your life around if you believe. If you believe, if you believe, the Bible says that God has given each of us a measure of faith so that we can believe. The Bible tells us that God has given us a measure of faith so we can put our trust and our confidence and our hope in God. The scripture says that faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. You've got to believe. You've got to believe. You've got to believe. The Bible says that he that cometh to God must first believe that he is, that God exists, that God is real, and that he is a rewarder to them that diligently seek him. If you trust in God, he can give you a new beginning. If you put your confidence in God, he can turn your things, your situation around. You know, I'm reminded of the fact that we all go through trials and tribulations. You know, the Bible says that a man that is born of a woman is of a few days and full of trouble. Now, we used to sing a song, Trouble.
turn around and say, I know why Jesus met up with Thomas so that he can be able to believe, so that he can be able to put his trust in the Lord, so that he would be able to carry out the mission that he was assigned to do, to spread this gospel, to spread the good news, to spread the word, to spread what needs to happen. And you know, when we think about how he came to believe, Jesus met him in his circumstance. You know, Jesus will meet you in your circumstance. You know, when you struggling people don't bother Jesus. He wants you to struggle. He wants to meet you in your struggle so he can meet you to help you in your time of need. So that you can cast all your care upon him. Oh, my God, my God, the best help I ever got from Jesus was when I was struggling. If we had some witnesses in the house today, the best help they got from Jesus, they found themselves struggling. Hallelujah, and Jesus met them in their hour of need. That's why the Bible said for us to come boldly to the throne of grace, that we might obtain mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. What I like about Jesus, that he's a mighty good leader, that he's a wonderful counselor, that his doors are never closed, that he's always open, and that he's always looking for somebody to call on his name. And if you call on the name of Jesus, thou shalt be saved. And if you call on the name of Jesus, you can be delivered. If you call on the name of Jesus, your situation can turn around. You know, the devil is on our track. He's always trying to turn us back.
You got to believe on the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. You got
He said, I'll never forsake you. And if you believe, he'll rescue you. If you believe, he'll knock the mind off. If you believe, your help is on the way. Come on and give God a praise. Thank God, Shanta. I believe God. Do you believe God? Do you believe God? Do you believe that he said, I am that I am? Do you believe that he's Jehovah Jireh? Do you believe that he's your provider? Come on and give God a praise. Shanta the Rosa. Hallelujah. We got to believe. Somebody, we gotta believe. You gotta believe. You gotta believe. You gotta believe and put your confidence in him. You know, sometimes I feel like preaching up in here. You know, sometimes, my God, when we're on this road and we're on this way, a lot of things attack our mind. A lot of situations happen to us. A life happens to us. But when I learned about by the prophet Abraham, the Bible says that he hoped against hope. Y'all hear me here today. The Bible says that he hoped against hope. And he was persuaded in God. Meaning that he trusted in God. And that he didn't stagger at the promises of God. And when I learned about God, when I learned about faith, is that faith is something that's eternal on the inside of you. It's eternal because it comes from God and it connects with God. And sometimes, and we being human, we go through ups and downs. Sometimes our faith wavers. Sometimes we get shaky in our faith. Abraham's faith wavers. Sometimes Abraham got a little shaky in his faith, but he never gave up hope in God. Oh God, who am I talking here today? Sometimes your faith is going to be tried. Sometimes you're going to feel like you're a double-minded person, unstable in all your ways. But there's some seed in you, and that seed in you is for faith. It's a compass that will lead you back to God. It's a compass that will lead you back to the one that's able to save your soul. It's a compass to the one that's able to deliver you out of all your circumstance and your situations. That's why Job was able to say, though you slay me, yet will I trust you. Don't doubt my heart. I'm going to put my trust in Jesus.
Do you believe that he has saved?
This story was written so that we might believe. Your story, though it isn't finished, but it's being written so that you might believe. The things that you go through in life are as a setup for you to believe in Jesus. Do you believe that? Do you believe that no weapon formed against you shall prosper? Do you believe that no temptation that has taken you much as is common to man, but your God is what? Your God is what? That won't suffer you to be tempted. Do you believe that your God has purpose? Do you believe that God has shown that you can call on the name of the Lord and you will show up? Do you believe? And in believing, you can be saved. That's the whole part about believing, that you can be saved. It's good that he healed my body, but what about my soul? My body is going to go back to the dust. Huh? Your body is going to go back to the dust. Your spirit is going to go back to God. Your soul is going to go back to God. And it's going to be a judgment to where you spend eternity based on your belief. Based on your belief. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father. What? Do you believe that? Do you believe that? So then you got to believe that Jesus died. Because the scripture says, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. We all sinners need to be saved by grace. It ain't a problem with sin. The problem is not giving up your sin. The problem is not trusting in Jesus. The problem is not having faith in the cross of Jesus Christ. Once you have faith in the cross of Jesus Christ, you say to God, I believe that your son died for me, that he gave up his life for me. And I want him to be my personal savior. Hallelujah. And once you believe and confess your sins and confess your faults, the Bible says that the blood of Jesus, it will cleanse you from all unrighteousness. And then you say, amen. And then you ask God to fill you with the precious gift of the Holy Ghost. Then you get baptized in the name of Jesus. Amen. Come on and give God a praise. God said, be born again. I believe, Jesus. I believe. And you know, Jesus told Thomas, doubting Thomas, told him that blessed are those that believe and have not seen, but yet believe. We're blessed. We haven't seen the Lord Jesus with our own eyes. We haven't handled him. We haven't touched him. But yet we what? But yet we what? So the Bible says we're blessed. Highly favored. Because we are utilizing our faith to believe in him that is able to save our soul. Come on and clap your hands and give God a praise. I want to be blessed. Let the church stand. I feel bad because I don't have water. My God, I'm going to have some water in a minute. Thank you, Lord. I can't swim with you. Thank you. Oh, Pastor, I'm going to be swimming. I'm trying to do this. I want to bury you. Amen. We're going to get it together. Tell somebody we're going to get it together. Amen. Don't talk about me. Pray for me, all right? Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. But we want to come before the Lord. We want to believe in the Lord. And if you have done anything wrong, and if you know that you need to repent of anything, now is the time to repent. Now is the time to ask the Lord to forgive you. Now is the time to ask for those new beginnings. And Lord knows our heart that if I could baptize you, I would. So let it impute to you for righteousness until we can baptize you. But until then, hallelujah, let us get our hearts right. Let us get our minds right. Let us
us get our spirit right. Let us get our soul right. Gracious Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we certainly thank you for this opportunity that we're standing here before this great people. We ask you, Lord, that you bless each and every soul that is here on today. We ask you, Lord, as they you receive their confession of faith, that you receive their confession of sin. Lord, we ask you that you blood wash them and cleanse them, and you purge them from all unrighteousness, from every word, thought, deed, and every secret thought, that you sanctify them holy in the name of Jesus, that you strengthen them, Lord, in their spirit, soul, and body. Lord, you see all of our struggles. You know everything that we're going through. Lord, you know that we need peace, that we need comfort, that we need strength, that we need answers, that we need help. Hallelujah, Lord, you promise that you'll supply all of our needs according to your riches and glory by Christ Jesus. And now, Lord, we ask you to pour it out. Let's pour out your blessing. Pour out your anointing. Pour out your strength. Pour out your grace. Pour out your glory. In the name of Jesus. And we receive it in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Come on, give God a praise. If you believe, you can have, you can receive in the name of Jesus. With uplifted hand, ask, and ye shall receive. Seek, and ye shall find. Knock, and the door shall be open. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on and give God a praise. We thank God for each and every one of you coming out to this afternoon. Amen. And now we are dismissed. I know that was a different benediction,